K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at advertise@k98talk.org. The leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Lord.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
Hey folks, Slickery Trigger here. I'd like to take a minute to tell you about Rebel Road Tactical. As a defensive pistol instructor, I've had the opportunity to observe many different holster designs and configurations. And one thing is clear. Many of my students won't carry a pistol. Or worse, they'll carry one without a holster at all. Holster designers aren't making holsters for normal people. It seems that most holsters are either an expensive piece of gear designed for Rambo or a piece that doesn't fit or function the way real people need it to fit and function. So, like any good Texan, I decided to learn to form kydex and design one myself, one that would fit the needs of average people. The result is the Rebel Road Tactical CRT Modular. The CRT stands for Carry, Range, and Training. Its thin and lightweight curved design minimizes printing and is adjustable to fit just right for superior comfort and function. Check us out after the show at rebelroadconcealed.blogspot.com.
You're listening to K98Talk.com, the way internet radio should be.
Well, hi, this is Denny C. with The Family Factor. We hope that this show will be a help to you as you search for answers with things, with problems, and issues within your family's life.
Now, here's Denny C. on The Family Factor.
Replay of the Family Factor. If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Well, hi everybody, this is Denny C, and today we're going to be remembering what took place on September 11th, 2001. Where were you on that day? I mean, let's think about it. It was a normal day. It was just a day. You took your kids to school. Maybe you went to walk the mall. You went to visit your friends. You went to work. Maybe you got fired in that morning. Maybe you were sick as a dog. But it was a normal day, right? And then it began. Everything in the world changed. I mean, on a clear, sunny, late summer day in September 2001, Al-Qaeda terrorists aboard three hijacked passenger planes carried out coordinated suicide attacks against the World Trade Center in New York City and the Pentagon in Washington, D.C., killing everyone on board the planes and nearly 3,000 people on the ground. A fourth plane crashed into the Pennsylvania field, killing all on board after the passengers and crews attempted to wrest control from the hijackers. So on that day, starting at 7:59 a.m., American Airlines Flight 11 of Boeing 767, with 92 people aboard, takes off from Boston Logan International Airport en route to Los Angeles. At 8:14 a.m., United Airlines Flight 175 of Boeing 767, with 65 people aboard, takes off from Boston. It's also headed to Los Angeles. At 8:19 a.m., flight attendants aboard the Flight 11, alerted the ground personnel that the plane had been hijacked. And American Airlines notifies the FBI. At 8:20 a.m., American Airlines Flight 77 takes off from Dulles International Airport outside of Washington, D.C. The Boeing 757 is headed to Los Angeles with 64 people aboard. And at 8:24 a.m., hijacker Mohammed Atta makes the first of two accidental transmissions from Flight 11 to ground control, apparently in attempt to communicate with the plane's cabin. At 8:40 a.m., the Federal Aviation Administration, the FAA, alerts North American Aerospace Defense Command, also known as NORAD, in the Northeast Air Defense Sector, NEADS, about the suspected hijacking of Flight 11. And in response, NEADS scrambles two fighter planes located at Cape Cod's Otis Air National Guard Base to locate and tail Flight 11. They are not yet in the air when Flight 11 crashes into the North Tower. At 8:41 a.m., United Airlines Flight 93, a Boeing 757 with 44 people aboard, takes off from the Newark International Airport en route to San Francisco. It had been scheduled to depart at 8 a.m. around the time of the other hijacked flights. At 8:46 a.m., Mohammed Atta and the other hijackers aboard American Airlines Flight 11 crashes the plane into floors 93 through 99 of the North Tower of the World Trade Center, killing everyone on board and hundreds inside the building. At 8:47 a.m., within seconds, NYPD and the FDNY forces dispatch units to the World Trade Center, while Port Authority Public Department officers on site begin immediate evacuation of the North Tower.
At 8:50 a.m., White House Chief of Staff Andrew Card alerts President George W. Bush that a plane was hit. The World Trade Center. The president is visiting an elementary school in Sarasota, Florida at that time. And I will never forget, they actually were filming him there when his guy comes to him, talks to him in his ear, and he has a change of face, and he's bowing up and down, shaking yes with his head. I'll never forget that live footage that they re-showed. At 9:02 a.m., after initially instructing tenants of the WTC's South Tower to remain in the building, Port Authority officials broadcast over to evacuate both towers via the public address system. An estimated 10,000 to 14,000 people are already in the process of evacuating. That's at 9:02 a.m. Only 9:02 a.m. Eastern Time. At 9:03 a.m., the hijackers crashed United Airlines Flight 175 into floors 75 through 85 of the WTC South Tower, killing the World Trade Center South Tower, killing everyone on board and hundreds inside the building. At 9:08 a.m., the FAA bans all takeoff of flights going to New York City or through the airspace around the city. At 9:21 a.m., the Port Authority closes all bridges and tunnels in the New York City area. At 9:24 a.m., the FAA notified needs of the suspected hijacking of Flight 77 after some passengers and crew aboard are able to alert family members on the ground. At 9:31 a.m., speaking from Florida, President Bush calls the events in New York City an apparent terrorist attack on our country, unquote. At 9:37 a.m., hijackers board Flight 77 crashed the plane into the western facade of the Pentagon of Washington, D.C., killing 59 aboard the plane and 125 military and civilian personnel inside the building. At 9:42 a.m., for the first time in history, the FAA grounds all flights over or bound for the continental United States. Some 3,300 commercial flights and 1,200 private planes are guided to airports in Canada and the United States over the next 2.5 hours. Now, before we move on in this time frame, let me tell you something. Those who were working that day in the airline system, and there was a short time that a good buddy of mine worked for Southwest Airlines, said it was madness for a complete day. You were constantly on the phone because of the fear that hit everybody. At 9:45 a.m., amid escalating rumors of the other attacks, the White House and the U.S. Capitol building are evacuated along with numerous other high-profile buildings, landmarks, and public spaces. At 9:59 a.m., the South Tower of the World Trade Center collapsed. So the whole South Tower then collapsed the way it was hit. At 10:07 a.m., after passengers and crew members aboard the hijacked Flight 93 contacts their friends and family and learns about the attacks in New York and Washington, they mount an attempt to retake the plane. In response, hijackers deliberately crash the plane into the field in Somerset County, Pennsylvania, killing all 40 passengers and crew aboard. That was at 10:07 a.m. At 10:28 a.m., the World Trade Center's North Tower collapses, 102 minutes after being struck by Flight 11. At 11 a.m., Mayor Rudolph Giuliani calls for the evacuation of Lower Manhattan south of Canal Street, including more than 1 million residents, workers, and tourists, as efforts continue throughout the afternoon to search for survivors at the World Trade Center. At 1 p.m., from a U.S. Air Force base in Louisiana, President Bush announces that the U.S. military forces are on high alert worldwide. At 2:51 p.m., the United States Navy dispatches missile destroyers to New York and Washington, D.C. At 5:20 p.m., the 47-story 7 World Trade Center collapses after burning for hours. The building had been evacuated in the morning, and there are no casualties, though the collapse forces rescue workers to flee for their lives. And at 6:58 p.m., President Bush returns to the White House after stops at military bases in Louisiana and Nebraska. And at 8:30 p.m., President Bush addressed the nation, calling the attacks evil, despicable acts of terror, and declaring that America, its friends and allies, would stand together to win the war against terrorism. And that's what happened that day. Now, a good friend of mine's wife was supposed to be in the World Trade Center for a meeting. And she overslept. And that's what saved her. She overslept. And then he went in to get her, and it took 3 days for him just to be able to get into New York to go through all the to be checked many times, to get his wife, and then to get out of there. You know, what about America? You know, right now we are talking about all kinds of things due to people running for office. And I know that today many of them will turn around and they will use today as a way to sell themselves to why you need to vote for them. But if they want to do something that even means greater, is to make or issue a statement, just a simple statement, that on this day they will do nothing nor say anything about themselves running for office, nor what they remembered, what they were doing, what was going on that day from their standpoint. In the fact of remembering, you know, from the right aspect and from the right mind, and with honor to the families of those that lost their loved ones, that today's 9/11, let our thoughts be there, not on me. Let their thoughts be there, not on these other people running for office. And I tell you right now, Mr. Trump, if you're listening to me or if this gets to you, I would say, sir, today is the day. If you really want to show the man you are, you will be quiet, silent, because I know you are that kind of man. You'll be silent in respect of this day. And you will win because of that aspect and that thought. And that's the same for all people running for office. Where were you on 9/11? What were you doing? For me, it was just a normal day. I got up, took my kids to school. And in those days, I was a pretty much more heavier guy than I am now. And I was at Weight Watchers. But I went to Weight Watchers, of course, while the reports were coming out. We already knew what was going on when we took our kids to school. We were wondering if the kids should go to school. And it was at noon, we pulled our kids out of school. Everybody did. They closed the schools. I lived in the Houston area back then, had a company. And in the Houston area, being we were centrally located off the Gulf, they had to take some deep concerns, as would that be another vital hit area for the terrorists. California, you know, I would not have wanted to live in California that day, because being a major commodity area, that could be a number one hit place again. I mean, what would they hit, though? You know, the Chinese theater, I don't know. But still, would they fly into Paramount? You know, would they go and take out Disneyland? I don't know. But the point is, for that day and for many days after, we as a nation, we became one people. Forget the rhetoric, forget the sides, forget the stupid Democratic Republican Party, and there were no Tea Parties and stuff back then, but forget all that. For that time period, at least a few months, it all stopped. We were one. We were there to rebandage ourselves as a nation. We were there to regrow ourselves as a nation. We were there to stand up together as a nation. We had become a family. This is the family factor. We had become a family as a nation. So, there are factors in the American families that break up our American family. And I'm talking as a nation. There are different factors within the American family as a whole, as an American nation family, that have broken it up. Why? You know, tonight, you need to listen to Rick's, you need to listen to his show, America Off the Rails. I hope you listened to it last night. But you need to listen to this show because he's going to talk about some very vital things on 9/11. He's going to speak his mind, which, you know, he spoke his mind the other day, and a lot of you hate him because of that. I thought that was interesting. I didn't actually get to hear the show. From what I understand, all of you who sent me a lot of letters and messages, why would I be on that show with that guy? I'll tell you why. Because even if I disagree with him or agree with him, he has the right kind of thoughts and statements on things. So 9/11. Well, one of the most amazing speeches I've ever heard, because it was no rhetoric. It was straight from the heart, right off the top, full of emotion, was this speech by former President George W. Bush. Let's take a listen.
Thank you all.
Look at him, George!
I want you all to know you can't go any louder. I want you all to know that America today is on bended knee in prayer for the people whose lives were lost here, for the workers who work here, for the families who mourn. This nation stands with the good people of New York City and New Jersey and Connecticut as we mourn the loss of thousands of our citizens. I can hear you. I can hear you. The rest of the world hears you. And the people who knocked these buildings down will hear all of us soon.
That plateau again, where unfortunately it takes something so vile and so mean to happen to innocent people to stand together as one people with rights, freedoms, liberties, and take out the trash that divides us and moves ahead. I'm going to put something out that I want you to think about. If we as a nation allow things that are so considered wrong by the God in which we do follow. I mean, in that speech, did you not hear the president and the people talk about their love for this nation and underneath the hand of Almighty God? Now, I'm not going to tell anybody what to believe when it comes to religion, so that's not the point I'm making. The point I'm making, though, is what's right is right, what's wrong is wrong. Either we as a nation strive hard as families that make up this nation to better our lives the right way, not through drugs, not through gross things that defeat the purpose, not through overeating, not through alcohol, not through smoking, not through pornography, not through, the list goes on and on. You get my point. If we as a nation stand tall but low in our hearts, as we do the best we can to bring out the best in each other through the right means, no one can defeat us. Let me say that again. We as a nation, starting with the American family, we as parents, we as children, we as grandparents, aunts, uncles, friends who are around kiddos, need to strive hard to bring out the best in each and every one of us. For in bringing out the best in each and every one of us, our nation will be so much stronger. By the same token, whether they're running for office or already in an elected office, hold these men and women accountable to bring out the best in their office, in their votes, to bring out the best in this nation. I think the hardest thing I've ever heard, which I can't go into great detail for definite security reasons, is the woes I hear from many of you guys and women that have served in the military forces, how some of you realize we had a way to defeat this and to defeat that, then at the same time, we could have went further, but they pulled you back, okay? Or that there's a lot more truth to the substance of what's really going on, and it eats at you that something else has to happen before we go to the next step. And then something else has to happen before we go to the next step. Well, let me say this to all you fighting men and women out there serving in our military forces. We pray for you daily. We thank you daily. We don't want to ever take you for granted. And that doesn't mean that you don't have your own private life issues. My hope is that we, as people who have friends and family that served in the armed forces, will always be there to build them up. Now, you may be saying, well, they just work at, they're at the base here in Oklahoma City, or they only work at the base in Louisiana down in Shreveport. You know what? Get off your high horses, those of you who think like that. They may work in just an office like that, but do you know the stuff they have to do on a daily basis, what they have to read, what they have to go over, what they have to... We don't know what all it is. And that brings me to another point. Do you realize that we have people that are shooting and trying to kill policemen? You know why that makes me angry? Because I have family members that are policemen. But besides that, you know why that makes me angry? Was it or has it not been for the whole that the police forces that are in these cities have done much good to the communities like our 9/11? Have you ever seen the video that was shot following with the fireman that goes into these messed up Twin Towers, and you also see the police officers there all struggling and striving to help save lives? And then you have a few bad apples, and I don't care, in families, in police officers, in firemen, in military, in any regime, doctors, whatever, lawyers, well, more lawyers than anybody else, I guess. But anyway, sorry, I had to have a pun on that. You have bad people, but that does not make the whole the bad, and therefore you're going to shoot any police officer that does something that you just don't like. We've got to get back to the roots of what brought us together as a nation of 9/11, and we need to keep it. And why does it always take an event like this, whether it's Pearl Harbor, the Civil War that we had back in the 1800s, the Twin Towers thing, why does it take something like this to bring our nation together as one? We overcome the inevitable and we put it back in its place. And then when things go back to normal, we divide up again. Why? I just do not understand. Well, we'll be right back after these words. This is Denny C. for the Family Factor, remembering 9/11. Are we any better? Right back at you.
You can reach Denny C. of The Family Factor by tweeting him at Family Factors or The Family Factor at live.com. The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
Listen to my story about a man named Jeb, a poor millionaire who could keep his family fed. But then one day he was talking to his pops. His pops spouted off, Jeb should try for the tops. Top office, that is. Presidente of the United States of America. The next thing you know, old Jeb makes a run. The whole time his brother says, this'll be fun. So now for 2016, that's how Jeb became the GOP's hillbilly. Now come on and vote for Jeb now. Y'all here? Tahoo!
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
You're listening to The Family Factor with Denny C. on K98Talk.com. Join him bright and early every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday as he covers issues that relate to the family. Denny encourages your calls and emails with topics you would like for him to discuss. So set your alarm for 5 a.m., grab that first cup of coffee, and join The Family Factor to start your day. Now back to Denny C. and more of The Family Factor.
American, where at least I know I'm free, and I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly
There ain't no doubt I love this.
Okay, everybody. God bless the USA. That's right. I tell you what. One of the things that I was looking at is there are families that have a remembrance of this date for different reasons. There is this hero of 9/11 that gave his life to save thousands. He had been called a prophet for being so ready for the attacks. The man who predicted 9/11 in a History Channel special and in A True American Hero by countless others. As tragic as the morning of September 11, 2011 was, the sky blue days still held unexpected miracles. And Richard, known as Rick Rascorla, was at the center of one of the greatest, the evacuation of financial services behemoth, Morgan Stanley. Rascorla, a 62-year-old retired and decorated U.S. Army colonel, had focused on security at the World Trade Center for years. And prior to the bombing of the Washington Trade Center in 1993, and while he was working in security for Dean Witter, he had approached the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey about security vulnerabilities in the World Trade Center's garage. He was told to focus only on his company's floors. Forget that, according to the biographer James Stewart. Not Jimmy Stewart, but James Stewart. He did that. But along with Dan Hill, a military buddy of his, he didn't stop thinking about security weaknesses and terrorism. After a company merger in 1997, Rascorla became director of security at Morgan Stanley, where he maintained vigilant attention to the firm's and the building's safety. Despite disruption at the busy brokerage firm, he insisted on holding twice yearly evacuation drills by the stairwell for the firm's 22 floors in the South Tower. Surely y'all have seen this on TV. I remember this man. And as the result of that, doing that evacuation twice a year, on September 11, 2001, guess what? His team was ready. Despite having received official instructions to stay put after the 846 crash next door, Rascorla told Morgan Stanley staffers to follow his evacuation plan and sent them two by two as they had practiced down the many flights of stairs. His decision and his preparation made all the difference. And although 13 employees, including himself, perished, more than 2,500 employees left the tower alive. That's where the word miracle comes in. It's also where the word hero comes in. According to the New Yorker, Rascorla used his cell phone to call Hill to get updates on news footage as he directed his employees by bullhorn. He was calm and collected, never raising his voice. Then Hill heard him break into song, the article notes. He also called his wife Susan, quote, "If something should happen to me, I want you to know I've never been happier," unquote. Doesn't that just break your heart? And there is a fuzzy photo of Rascorla speaking into the bullhorn that exists online. He was last seen on the 10th floor heading upstairs to two young adults. Rascorla was simply known as Dad. His daughter Kim, now 33, was in law school at Stanton Hall University in Newark, New Jersey at the time. She and her brother Trevor, now 35, were living with their mom. Rascorla's first wife, Betsy, in Morristown, New Jersey, when the attacks occurred. They were not surprised that he died in the line of duty. Trevor says, quote, "I knew he would be the last person out because it was his command. And as long as there were people in there, he would try to get them out," unquote. He went on to say, quote, it was part of who my father was, or I should say his daughter says this. "He stayed to help evacuate the building in 1993. It would not have done anything different that day," unquote, she said. Now, Richard Rick Rascorla, military service has been memorialized widely. A photo of him in the battle was the cover of the 1992 book, We Were Soldiers Once and Young, in Fort Benning, Georgia. and it displays a statue of him. He fought in a major battle in 1965 in Vietnam at La Dreng, a communist stronghold and a major supply route. He led his company in securing a defense perimeter, and after enduring waves of assault, kept his men's spirits up by leading them in singing military songs through the night. With the title of a 2002 biography and opera debuting in the weekend, this weekend in San Francisco, the details for Squirrel's sacrifice on September 11th may best define him as, quote, the heart of a soldier, unquote. His daughter went on to say, quote, we were part of a community of those that had lost their loved ones. And although each loss was unique, no loss was more poignant or devastating than any other. She went on to say, quote, in addition, we were bombarded with images of the collapse of the towers, and I knew as I watched the towers fall, I also was witnessing the murder of my father, unquote. His son went on to say, Trevor did, quote, every day there was something that reminded me of my father, unquote. So how did 9/11 change them? His daughter Kim went on to say, quote, I had been unaware of anything outside of my family, my friends, and my studies. I became cognizant of the world being a much larger place. Prior to 9/11, I could not have conceived that we were people so consumed by hate and desperation that they would be capable and willing to sacrifice themselves to viciously murder people they had never met. She went on to say, I chose to focus on my career in estate planning and estate administration because many of those that perish did so without estate planning documents, causing administrative burdens for their families at a time of emotional turmoil, unquote. And my hat's off to his daughter, Kim. His son, Trevor, went on to say, quote, I am sure that my father's background has shaped my interest in helping people. He instilled in me a sense that there is a duty to help your fellows in the perspective that we are all only a trick of fate from being in the same position as someone else, unquote. He went on to say, he always impressed me. He always impressed upon me the need to be my own man, follow my own path, but who he was, had, and does have a significant influence on who I am. Unquote. So as we look at today of 9/11, please understand, are we going to continually return back to the carefree, careless societies of America? Or are we going to, once again, through, it's going to take another bombing, perhaps a nuclear war, to bring us back together again as a nation? We've got to get off of racism. We've got to get off of judgment of everybody when they disagree with us and work on a common goal of standing together under, and pardon my words, but I'm going to say it, under God's word, to be a one nation, united, striving hard, together, looking to each other's needs. When one of us offends one another, forgiving one another. Starting in our families. If our families become very strong, we don't have all these divorces going on, and single-parent families, and I'm not talking due to a life crisis where one of the parents passed away. I'm talking about where, fine, I'll just go live on my own, see you later, take care of that kid, whatever. If we would, as a family unit, become a strong family unit and we teach our children the same thoughts, we would be a different nation. We would elect different officials. And those that are in these positions would be different because of their backgrounds, being the family I'm talking about. And we would be a one united family as a whole. Because people, it's only going to get worse on the outside of our nation. And either we take a stand together to strive hard to care about our neighbors as ourselves, to treat them as we want to be treated, and work hard to live long in a good and honest way. Or we can lie. We can get away with all kinds of deceits, and it will come back upon us. That's my thought for remembering 9/11. Are we any better now than we were then? Have we learned anything? Are we going to sound like they did when the president was speaking, the former president George W. Bush was speaking in his bullhorn, where those people were all together saying things like USA, USA, USA? This is Denny C. Please think about that, and you can write me at The Family Factors on Twitter or at thefamilyfactor@live.com. Again, are we going to sound like that, or are we not? Well, this is Denny C. We thank you for tuning in today, and again, we'll be here Monday. Again, you can write to me, but please let me know. We will eventually be a call-in show, but at this time, I don't think many of you want to call me at 6 in the morning. So y'all have a good day and a great weekend.
Thank you for tuning in to The Family Factor with Denny C. Be sure to join him every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 5 a.m. right here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.